Okay, so now the documentation approach in Agile. This is very different than whatever we used to do in the waterfall or any other traditional method, right? So what is like, you should begin your documentation with analysis. What you need to do, who are your users, and what kind of deliverables you will need. Is it a user documentation, or the target audience is a developer? You may need to come up with some API documentation, and so many things, right? So first analyze, and then when to start, right? That is the biggest question in Agile. So when to start, certainly in initial sprints, you don't have much to do, right? Because you don't have enough resources to refer to or anything, you don't have any prototype. So that time you can start with understanding, creating your doc epic, doing research, talking to your SMEs, and you should keep note of all such things, because in Agile we don't have a very comprehensive technical specification doc, right? We cannot say that there is no technical doc, but certainly that is very minimal, right? And then, because documentation is done in a modular way, we just pick one part of documentation, one chunk, right? It is not that you start writing one feature and then you end in continuation, right? Maybe in one sprint you might be working only on, you can say conceptual information. Next sprint you might be focusing on procedure. So you should ensure that when all the sprints are over, you do not lose your content, right? So at the end of all sprints, all documentation should be available for integration and delivery. So decide wisely, and maybe you can use your content management system or whatever way that you need to identify based on the resources available in your organization. And then how? So yeah, again, start with small chunks, start with understanding, and then initial sprints you don't have UI or any prototype. Mostly that comes during mid-sprint, or most of the time it comes during the towards the last of the release. So start with small chunks, start with conceptual information, maybe use cases writing, something, and then you go ahead. Build the content as you progress. And the good thing is you don't need to write too comprehensive, too lengthy documentation. Your doc should contain only necessary information. And other benefit is work is well distributed over the cycle, over the sprint, multiple sprints. So it is not that, dev is done, QA is done, and at last you are in hurry to finish the documentation. And you may not get time of engineering also, because they might be completed their work and then they can move ahead to some other work. So it will be difficult for them also. So that is another good thing in Agile. Yeah, so in nutshell, it's a kiss and kill principle. So kiss and kill is keep it simple and keep it light. Yeah, so use cases, I mean to say business use cases, not the functional, not the test cases kind of. So use cases are like scenarios where this user is going to be used, what are doing, that kind of.
Write that up.
Yeah, we mostly, we are involved with PM, product manager, and sometimes the customer facing persons like technical support or consultants or partners.
So usually, if I can just add to that, usually the PMs would get the requirements and they would have some sort of that information available with them, and we can build on that information in consultation with the PMs. At this point of time, we mostly work with the PMs. And later, probably towards the hardening sprints or so, we consult technical support as well in case there is a change or something that needs to be some angle from their side. Because PM talks more from the customer side, you know, in a very specific, from a selling point of view. Whereas technical people, like support team, would want to add some more technical details into it, so that kind of complements it.
Yeah, they know what problem a customer is facing, right? So maybe if we are, so it is kind of marketing material, not exactly marketing, but still, I mean, you should give some pointers. If someone is looking at new feature, they should know, okay, this is the scenario, I can use this feature. That's right. Yes, right. Yeah.
It kind of sells your feature more, you know, in a better way than just writing the user documentation. When you say to benefits that use cases, it helps. I mean, for example, you are a reader, you would look at the benefits or the use cases. You can map to your requirements or your environment and then choose to, you know, whether I should really upgrade to this or not. That's how we also, you know, kind of upgrade our products.
Any more questions?
Yeah,
Sorry.
I just wanted to ask,
okay, so now over to Jyotsana. She will talk about ultimate approach in Agile.
So what do you all think about the ultimate approach? I mean, many of you have been working in Agile, right? So what is your experience, or rather, what do you think a bolting approach?
Yeah, you might be using some different terms. So what you can think about this term? I mean, any idea?
Interaction, lot of interaction.
Whole team effort, in sense, we just split up the features and each one gets to work on.
Okay, that's fair enough. So to consider a user story complete, all the allied functions, which means it could be dev, QA, and doc, or it could be just dev and QA, all of them have to do their specific tasks in order to say that the story is complete. So which means that at the planning stage, when they plan a task, that time, if there is a doc impact of that user story, effort will be considered for reviews, or it could be even for giving inputs. So which means from the dev side, they will actually put effort for either a review or for an input or any other type. It could be a training also for a doc member. So that part is already taken care of. Now when that is taken care of, the doc people do not have to run too much around for reviews, because the effort is already in the plan. And your developer will, in most of the cases, cannot run away, which is usually, you know, people kind of rant about that. The dev would definitely have to give attention to doc for a review or for an input or a consultation or whatever it is. So with that, it makes the life of, you know, a document writer easy. And then with that, when you get timely inputs, you can get timely reviews also done. So that makes the life of doc people easy. And then the other advantage with whole team effort is that documentation people are at par with the other team members. So there are no specific entities like a doc member or a QA member or you know, a developer. It's like a scrum team which is supposed to do finish a function or complete a function. And those singular entities don't really matter. It's the team, the agile team or the scrum team that we call, which matters. And they are supposed to finish a job, and that is how they work together. So that is very advantageous to the doc members. And doc get actually, you know, you get to attend many meetings because you are equal part of the team. With that, you get a voice to talk about, it could be anything. It could be you want to assert a point, it could be about something is not going right, or maybe an impediment or a problem or something. So you get an opportunity to talk, where you can talk whatever you feel like. Now it is up to the doc member to voice out. Unless, you know, the doc person does not voice out, the other, you know, members may not know what is there with the doc. But yes, Agile in this way works for doc, because the doc is at par with the rest of the team. So there's no specific entity like doc. We all work together as a team. Okay, now as I said, Agile really works. We have experienced it in our organization. I'm sure most of you also would be thinking, whoever is working in Agile. Yes, with many good things, there are some challenges also, you know. So we have tried to highlight some of the challenge that we have faced. Okay, so things are pretty okay when you are working in one Agile team. Yes, handling meetings becomes, it's taxing at times, but when you are part of different, you know, Agile teams, things go just bonkers. I mean, your life is in mess. Because you could be thinking whether we should attend meetings or actually start working, you know, concentrate on working or concentrate on conceptual information, because different Agile teams will work at different places. Not all of them will start at the same time and finish at the same time. So it's very important to understand how to handle meetings and how to gauge your capacity. I think I'm enough audible.
Yeah.
Okay. So capacity planning becomes really difficult when you are working with multiple Agile teams. Meetings on top of it is very difficult to handle. And communication, to be on top of all the communication for all the teams, I think one will get just that. So these are some top challenges that most of us face in our daily, day-to-day life. The other thing which often happens is that documentation, now we spend so much of time writing, understanding concepts and things like that, and finally we get to write information. And at later point of time, we are told that, you know, we have to discard this documentation, because Agile is all about dynamic environment. It's about change all the time, so there's no fixed thing. So, one fine day, we are told that there's a change in the feature and it has to be discarded. Yes, it feels bad. I mean, we should not be emotionally attached to the dog, but we can't help it. I mean, it's as much as it's, you know, painful for us, it's painful for the code, I mean, for the developers also, whose code gets discarded. So that's something that also comes up as a challenge, because we spend so much of time on, you know, the hard work that goes into the kind of planning and writing and all of that. Yeah, these are some of the challenges. Okay, she'll talk about the rest of the challenges.
So next challenge is, like I already covered it, like the lack of enough resources to look at in the initial sprints, right? So maybe sometimes what we find that initially sprint they use for writing the technical specification, though it is a bare minimum, but still sometimes they spend on that. So maybe in the first sprint you might not be having anything to look at, right? Second thing is, as Jyotsana discussed about the code being discarded. So most of the time discarding is a rare thing, but most of the time what happens, they just change here and there, small changes, right? Effort-wise, it's not that much, but you need to keep tab of everything, right? So if you have, if some UI string is changed, right? In your doc, if it is not updated, it looks bad, right? Customer may have complaints, they might be confused, okay, why doc is different than UI? So that is another challenge. Even if you are working on one team or you are working with a different scrum team, if you are working with remote team members, it really becomes challenging at times, because you have daily standards, you have many meetings, right, that you cannot do over emails or something. So you need to adjust your timings of meeting. I mean, sometimes maybe early morning or sometimes late evening. So that is another challenge. Then last minute changes, this is nothing new with Agile. I think this is global issue. I mean, in any methodology you use, last minute changes you cannot avoid, right?
It is true of documentation, whichever model you follow.
So, and then edit reviews. So because you write in chunks, you write in small portions, when to send it for edit reviews, when to send it for peer review, right? You cannot every day send something to your colleague or someone, okay, today you review this and then tomorrow you review this, right? So what we do, we send it towards the end of the sprints. Once the product is stabilized or some few technical intermittent reviews are done. So towards end we send. So yeah, so somehow it's working for us.
It doesn't work for you?
It doesn't work.
Okay, so these are few challenges
we have to say. Yeah, sorry.
One picture when we are done with one picture. See that same picture content will come in.
You won't find?
No, it will come in a result guide, it will come in a administration guide. The same content will come in the business concept guide also. So that time we can't tell, I'll give the end and send it to you. So what we do is we assign a JIRA for one that particular feature, saying that these three links are for three guides and you review. 2 days time we will give for peer review. It has to be otherwise, end of the month.
Yes, certainly that you have to take this, I mean, decision wisely and based on your schedule and other systems. Yeah, you cannot have any hard and fast rule. It depends on the product, the team, the context also, right? So certainly we cannot say, okay, this is the one best practice. Right?
Yeah, because after peer, it has to go to the manager, then it has to go for the PM. So we can't give it.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so these were the challenges that we mostly face. Anyone have anything?
Do you have a format
of
how the
document
should be?
I mean, it depends on your deliverable. I don't think there is any different format for.
You can ask if you have a specific question.
You can ask.
Yeah.
Maybe after. See,
we have this 2 to 3 weeks, and within that, the whole development, testing, and everything will requirement also. So the delivery went to the client side as well. So should we include any user kind of end user kind of space also in the should we?
Actually we don't use many screenshots because of various reasons. One is maintenance problem, right? Every time if there is any change, you have to change the screenshot. Other thing, you may not want to show your computer how your UI looks, right? So if you give very too many screenshots, anyone can go there and look at, okay, suppose you are working with Oracle and your computer is Microsoft, just one example. If you put too many screenshots without buying their software, they can know, right, how it looks.
You know, you are exposing your software to the public domain. Anybody can come and look at your screens. That's one part of it that she is trying to say.
Yeah, maybe we can discuss it later because it's not the scope of the.
But we can.
We can help with that.
Anything else? Any other?
Looks like everybody is good with Agile here.
Yeah. No, this, like you mentioned, like you are doing the review at the end. But if you're working on topic page, so that time it should not be a problem. So that topic can go to the review immediately.
Yes, right, exactly. I mean, that decision you have to take. If you think, okay, this is a logical unit, you can send it for review. You can please go ahead and send. So, but you cannot send it in between, right? So if you are just writing first draft of your overview, and if you send it, that will not make sense.
It has to be a logical block. That is what she is trying to say. When you have a logical block complete and you have the confidence that this is what it is, send it. That will reduce the number of iterations, because then after that, if you are updating the doc with teams, you will have the confidence, you would know how the team is progressing.
That's why I'm
with the development.
If you're working on topic based.
Right.
Each topic is
so each logical
HTML file.
Probably we can say a logical unit instead of a topic.
Yeah.
You know.
So what we follow in our place is like part of the planning, we have our practice where in 2-3 days before we send a mail to the PMs telling this is coming up. Please keep your
heads up.
Yeah.
That works for all.
What we do, we send it months in advance actually. So we share our doc plan with even with PM, okay? We just highlight that, okay, these are the dates you will get some content to review. Yeah. So
usually that was required to be involved there. So how that helps is that, you know, we are, you know, kind of keeping them informed of the schedule. And then once we start with heads up mails and all, they kind of, you know, understand that, okay, now this is coming up and I have to spend time. Not that there is always 100% success with that.
Yes.
Most of the times we end up having meetings, either round table or go to meetings, I mean, if they are not around or something. But planning helps in a lot, you know, in actually addressing a lot of such issues.
Now some best practices.
See, with Agile, the best part is that you are involved throughout. And if you start planning where actually you have to plan, I think most of the things will fall in place. If you do your groundwork, write it at the beginning, you will have a lot of information about what's coming up.
Yeah, so she has already covered the research part. So yeah, you need to do lots of research, and the expectation is more in Agile. So the team thinks that, okay, you have some knowledge and you have to put more effort suddenly. You cannot simply rely on for everything on the engineering team. So do research, talk to SMEs, don't hesitate, don't shy. So and then be involved. So be involved, what I mean here is be involved in all activities or all stages of the development, be it a research or design or planning or development, testing or UI. Okay. So we are better person to suggest on UI. Not UI design, but at least on the UI streams, what to use, what to not use, what the style should be and all those stuff. So the team will also feel okay, they are not just doing their documentation task, right? They will also feel associated, I mean, it will be like one closely knit team, right? Then plan your capacity. Yeah, so this is very crucial point. If you are associated, if you are working with multiple Scrum teams, it becomes more important. So plan your capacity, and if you think, okay, you are not able to manage all those work, proactively go and talk to your supervisor or manager, right? Instead of just sit idle and waiting for something bad to happen. So go and talk to your manager. And then to come up with a good capacity, certainly you need to know more about the feature or the product, right? So research helps you there. Yeah, so maybe Jyotsana will.
Okay. So we just thought of sharing a capacity plan that we do in our company. Usually we do capacity over the length of the sprints, which means for a full release. So this is the capacity plan. This is a sample one, very old one, but you can always have a look. So in this capacity, we determine the capacity for the team members, anybody who is working on. As you see that, for example, this lady called Meredith, she is working on 7.1 migration utility, then some of the project management tasks and non-sentinel work. So depending on the role, you might have to work on different things, which also includes your documentation and some of the project management tasks or any other tasks that you are mentoring or something like that. So a capacity plan helps a lot to figure out the capacity for a person, and once you feel that okay, my capacity is utilized well, probably you don't have any issues. But if you think that you are being overutilized per your capacity, then you can have a talk with your manager and then, you know, decide how to go about it. I mean, the idea is that we need not slog, and we can probably streamline the effort across so that we don't get burnt in the process. And the team also gets benefited. So this is, you have any questions on this capacity sheet? Anybody? Are you guys using any capacity sheets for? No?
No. Those are
ours.
Ours today. Yeah, and then you can see we have, if you have any planned vacation or holiday coming up, everything is accounted here. So you can, I mean, you can have a holistic view of your workday.
So basically it is utilization per hours. Yes. The number of hours the person is going to work and what.
Yeah, if you are involved with multiple things, then that helps.
Do you have any system has to account for that? So that cannot be predicted, right?
No, no, you have any,
see, there are, I can share my experience. Being a lead, I can tell you that there are three things. Either you have to cut down on scope, or you have to increase resources, or you have to increase time. There are only three things to it.
Increase time is best.
That's a wishful thinking. I wish that was possible. Yes, but we have to do one of these.
But is that prioritization?
And your negotiation skills should be so strong that you should be able to negotiate it with the project manager or the team. The thing is that it has to be communicated. So once you break that, once you communicate that, it helps the other the stakeholders to think through what is important, what is urgent. They will be able to judge that. For example, something has to be delivered, maybe in a couple of days, and the writer is not available for whatever emergency. So we have to figure out a way to deliver that. Probably we'll have to stop some non-urgent work where we can focus on this work and ship it. So that is the call, that's a situational kind of management where we have to see what needs to go out, what we can still, deliberate and probably, because not everything will go out at the same time. So that's where we have to take a call on that.
Yeah, sometimes your co-writer can help you. Right? Come back up.
Back up writer.
And then you can take leave and put the same
work. Yeah, that's a good strategy.
I think one more slide is there.
Did that answer your question?
Yeah, somewhat. Because I thought cut down the work, prioritize your work.
Yes, that is. What is urgent has to go out. So that's prior.
Yeah, that is another benefit of Agile. So you are not, if you are on vacation, you will not lose everything, right? You will still have further sprints to catch up your work. It is not that, okay, everyone is waiting for dock. I mean, till dock is done, you cannot release. Right?
Sorry.
Yeah, so speak up. So I think Jyotsana has talked enough about speaking up, so I'm just skipping this topic. Anyone has anything on this?
See, we should not be mute spectators. I always tell this to the team also. If you have a slight doubt in your mind, talk about it. Be assertive, be positive. We are not here to blame each other. We are only here to correct the process if something is wrong in the process. So be objective and talk about it. Whether it's about time, whether it's about negotiating, anything else, we have to be objective and we should talk about it. Unless we talk, how are we supposed to know the other person knows it?
Yeah, and if you have any advice also, that also, just don't talk about any issues or complain always.
You can go on complaining for
so maybe
one full year.
You might have some better idea on the product, right? Maybe some better way of UI or anything. So, try to be part of the team. Next point is start small. Yeah, okay, sorry. So start with the small, don't wait for everything to be done. That way you will lose time and you will end up working like a traditional way of working, right? So start with the small, whatever information is available, start with that and then build it up. Okay, and then documentation should not be very lengthy, keep it light and keep it simple as we talked about earlier. So trim the excess content, read and read and read, unless until you think, okay, this is the thing, you cannot trim it further. Okay, and then how to cope up with the last minute changes. So most of the time what happens, the team tends to work on UI towards the last phase of the release, and mostly towards the last sprint. They focus more on the back end part. So in initial sprints or maybe planning meetings, you emphasize that how it impacts on your dog, right? So try to have it done in earlier or mid sprints. So most of the time what happens, most of the changes impacts that is related to the UI, right?
I have a question on trim the excess content. Now usually when you have documentation, you would trim the excess things, especially when you have localization involved, right? Translations involved, cost stuff. Mm-hmm. What if you don't have those things involved? Do you think it's still appropriate to trim?
Yes, because I mean what we feel like, user guides are not like fiction, right? No one will read it by, I mean.
Well, nobody reads a user guide anyway.
Yeah.
You can make them, right?
But you can make it interesting.
We take so much effort. I mean, I have seen where people, I have to explain, I'm sure many people go through. Like you tell someone, what do you do for a living? So you tell them, I'm a technical writer. What? What do you even do? What do you write? And then you explain them that maybe, you know, we write these documentations. Mm-hmm. Who even reads them? It's like an insult right on our face, right? They just literally, you know, it's like throwing a cake right on your face.
Yeah, so that is why you should not be very comprehensive. So if someone is in trouble, they have lack of knowledge, they, at that time they refer to documentation, right? So you should provide to the point information. They should not be lost within the ocean of information, right?
So you still cut out the articles anyway.
And one more thing. To what Archana said is, I think in this whole team approach, we are involved at right from the beginning. So the documentation people should involve to the extent where we should try to help the team to improve the UI, you know, a better UI. I'm sure those will not get discarded, at least in our company. They do respect technical writers' review. Not just the review of UI, not just a string review, but even the placement of the screen, I mean elements, GUI elements, and whether we should really have a string of screens, you know, starting from in the wizard, for example, from screen 1 to screen 10, do we really need to have 10? So probably if we get involved in all such kinds of things, it will actually help improve the product, and in turn it will reduce the, you know, number of pages we fill in, because most of the times we end up with I would say that, you know, all the deficiencies that are there in the product are actually added to the document. So we probably, that's one way of looking at it where we can help, you know, from the content. The other part is that because we write modular content in Agile, so the concept of Agile, I mean documentation is Agile, is just write enough. Don't fill pages and pages. So that's another thing that she was trying to say.
Okay, so last two points, I will cover it quickly. And I guess we will not have time for questions, so I will share our email IDs, okay? Okay, so not in our case, but some of the organization, some of the friends I came across, they are saying, okay, so in Agile, when sprint ends, immediately they release the product, right? So that time you may not have enough time to integrate your dog, work on it, review comments, and there are many things that we do, right, before publishing the dog. So if that is the case, please ask for some hardening sprint for documentation, at least a couple of days. Otherwise, you would compromise on the quality. And last is skip meetings. Yeah, we emphasized on being involved, attending all the meetings, but please attend the meeting wisely. I mean, just think about how this meeting is going to help you or the documentation, right? Some meetings you will be just waste of your time, like code reviews, right, or use case reviews. You would be, I mean, invited because you are part of this scrum, but you may not need to attend that. So skip meeting, don't try to attend everything, that is not useful.
And you can involve your, keep your manager or your supervisor informed about the decision that you are taking, because sometimes it has been seen that you know, if you don't attend meetings, then the project manager will send a mail to your manager that this person has not attended in meeting, whether that meeting is useful or not, but the presence is required. So be wise, be prudent, consult your manager and strike a chord, and then attend the meetings which are required. I mean, attending meetings is not all we do, that's just part of it. We also have to do our work.
So questions, I guess we have
any questions?
Any questions that we can quickly answer?
We can vote right now.
If if anything comes across your mind, any suggestion, any feedback, or any question, anything, please feel free to contact us on this.
Huge round of applause, please. I mean, the kind of scenarios which Archana and Jyotsana actually spoke about, we go through these things every day, right, where we have to, even if we think of skipping the meeting, or even if we did for once, and the next minute you see that email, right?
Yes.
So many people. I've gone through it. So as she said, you need to decide what your priorities are. It's like about getting your priorities straightened over here and making sure that your manager understands your priorities and supports you for that, which is very important. I think in a role of a technical writer, it's very important that you have a very supportive manager and who understands your role more than anybody else. Most people think, like I have seen where engineers think that our role does not matter at all. They only include us when it comes to, oh, you know what? You haven't done a good job. The documentation is not right. You haven't written it right. There's something wrong over here. And what they do is, this thing happens right at the end, as you said. Right at the end, okay? This is like an 11th hour thing, and then they come complaining about it. And if you don't get sorted on time, the next minute you have like a meeting set up from your manager calling you. Or, you know, you have a call on your desk. Can you, like, you know, maybe like meet for like for 15 minutes and you know what's going to happen. Right? Well, real life scenarios. Yeah, use cases. All right, thank you so much, Jyotsana and Archana. And I would like to present you this memento.